Antes de pensar, hay que observar. L'orientation de mes présentations, voy a cambiar de español a inglés. My presentation, we start from the fact that we should have a common diagnosis about what is happening. And the big and interesting thing is that emerging economies have been anticipating a lot about the evolution of the present crisis. Because why crisis and especially are so interesting? Because in good times, every economic theory is good enough. Everybody's right, Keynesian, neoclassical, Strachan. When the crisis comes, no theory is available. So it is a wonderful time for theoreticians. Not only heterodox, but all of them. And I think that second thing, the malaise of modern economies began at the periphery with ASEAN crisis, with Argentina crisis, with, in a sense, periphery has been experimenting what is now the central crisis in Eurozone or US before. And if you study their trajectory, we can first assess what is the future of financial globalization. I think it is highly at risk. Second, we could have a kind of spectrography of the world economy. The world economy is much more diverse than globalization pretended to be. Then you can understand that maybe you have a new shift in the world in the sense that Latin America and Asia might become complementary. And the isolation will be poor Europe and still powerful US. In the sense, we might imagine a shifting of history, not only shifting in the term of Asia as manufacturer, but also a new equilibrium between raw materials producing countries and industrial countries. And last but not least, many emerging countries have been innovating in new forms of economic policy where orthodoxy is prevailing in the center. And we can learn 14 lessons. The first one is that it is very dangerous to go into debt in foreign currency. What is the drama of Greece? The drama of Greece go to debt in euro, whereas the Central Bank of Greece could not emit anymore euros. And therefore, in a sense, you are finding again the same problem as ASEAN crisis, Argentina crisis, and many other crises. And the big interesting thing is the following. In the right-hand column, you have the proportion of credit in foreign currency. As soon as you have a very high level of dependency to foreign currency, the likelihood of a foreign crisis is financial crisis is very high, like in Lithuania, Hungary, and so on. Whereas in the right-hand column, you have the country with experience previous crises. They have been very careful never again to go into debt in dollars or in any foreign currency. Then you have a second lesson. Governments learned from their own crises. For example, Mr. Bernanke learned from the 29 crises that he should not cut the liquidity. So in a sense, you have a national trajectory. But the US has not been learning so much about the Japanese long-term stagnation. You learn from your own mistake. You don't learn the mistake of others. And I think it is a pity because by observation, we should have a cumulative asset of findings about how to prevent crises. The third lesson, I think emerging countries were very lucky. The Chinese authorities have been blocking the sales of sophisticated derivatives. So they intoxicated Swiss banks and German banks. But if you prevent to enter the most modern and dangerous financial products, you have a typical oversupply crisis, but you are not lagging. And what is very impressive, look at this figure. This is the long-term balance of financial asset evolution of the US. You see that until the mid-80s, the credits to traders, commercial banks, consumers were in parallel. And the big novelty with financial liberalization is that the explosion of the red curve is simply the credit granted to institutional financial institutions by themselves. In a sense, you use credit in order to speculate. it was not very good for the American economy in the sense, be careful, some financial innovations are such devastating negative externality that it's good to stop, to be not at the forefront of financial innovation, especially when you have very dangerous products. Then, let's follow another lesson. You had, before the crisis, a very intense debate. Do we have this connection? For example, will China be independent from the crisis of the US? Or do we have a leading role of China in emerging? So you have a problem. The answer of the regulationist is a very much more complex one. Is that in fact, and it is a normal finding of international theory, you have a cumulative differentiation of national configurations. In the sense that when you exchange, what is your main competitive asset? It is your institutional setting. Some know how to produce medicines, others, like in Germany, know how to make sophisticated machine tools, others are expert in assembling consumer goods. Therefore, we have the following trajectory of the world economy. Imagine first, you have financial hegemony. If you are looking carefully, you do the macroeconomic analysis of the world economy. The core of the impulsion was US and UK. The crisis started with Lehman Brothers. It was, in a sense, American-made, even it was highly dependent from the inflow of Chinese saving. And there, you have a dialectic evolution with China, especially in the sense China was providing low-price consumer goods, sustaining the stability of real income of average citizens, and the excess of their balance of payment were sent back to the US in order to fuel low interest rates. So you have you seem to have a duopoly. But the story is a little more complex because after all, to all, rentier economies, economies producing raw materials. Because when you have both China and US booming, they benefit so much, and as Ocampo just showed, you have a huge accumulation of saving in rentier economy. They play a major role, first, in the evolution of the circular value, and second, in the financing of the world. And then why the world is so complex? Because you don't have any more American hegemony, you don't have Chinese hegemony, you don't have OPEC hegemony, but you have a complex bargaining power in which no actor has the power to impose it. And then you have depending countries. What is interesting, you have a hierarchy in the world economy. Nobody is equal. You have some are more equals than others. The less equal, of course, take the most dependent countries, where, for example, the poor case would be Iceland, Ireland, playing only borrowing money out of UK. This is a very dangerous game because as you have a sudden stop, the model is no more viable. But you have another configuration, which is very important to understand. Where the country where the recession after the Lehman Brothers shock was the most intense? In Germany and Japan, because we are specialized in exchanging sophisticated, intermediate, and productive goods. In a sense, we are highly competitive intrinsically, but we are so dependent on the world economy that they cannot master their own macroeconomic activity. And in a sense, for example, for French people, Germany is a very important actor. But at the world level, Germany is not at all the equivalent of China because they cannot move the world economy. They are moved by the world economy. So you understand why the analysis of the hierarchy of the world economy is so important. And then you have, and I might say that just to add that, you had hybrid forms. Let me add France. France has a major difficulty in the sense we had very state-led institutions, and we began to internationalize, to join Europe and Euro. And in a sense, what is the political drama of France? The desynchronization of national institutions make the insertion into the world economy very problematic. And it was an extremist case was Argentina, in the sense that you are so well articulated to the world economy that you destroy the competitiveness and the social fabric of Argentina. You should remember that for some country, globalization is destroying. And if you are looking carefully at what's happening in Greece, you are decomposing the Greek society, really, in the sense that the elite is going out, people are going from the town to the rural zone, in a sense. And so, yeah, and of course, let's have a tribute to this famous North Korean country. Some countries might prefer to be totally autonomous, but you see, and you understand clearly that they have no world role, and it's not sure that they have a clear role in sustaining the welfare. So the conclusion of this part is, be careful, we are living unprecedented complexity of the world economy, which make, where is not any Stackelberg leader. Americans believe they are still the American leader, but the real Stackelberg leader are Chinese government, de facto. If we play the first one, the world economy would have to apply. Then let's follow the lesson. Let me take the issue of globalization and inequality. I have very good friends in France that say that inequality is a global phenomenon. You can find a universal mechanism in order to understand. I dissent, and I will propose you a very complex mechanism, but I will describe briefly. In the US, you have simply the fact that with the breaking down of the Fordist capital labor compromise, skilled workers benefit a lot of internationalization, low-skilled workers are penalized. Second, you open to the world of finance. Some people are very clever in managing their portfolio, others have no portfolio. And third, if you have a lobby from the finance, you are much more powerful than the lobby of the people defending against foreclosure. So the first element of inequality is unequal economic and political power in the new context of the world economy. Let's go to China and Asia. In Asia, you explore the phase one of Kuznets curve. You have a very low productivity sector. People shift from the rural zone to the urban zone with high productivity. So endogenously, even if you remove corruption or things like this, you have cumulativeness of rising inequality, which is like the industrialization of Great Britain. So in a sense, you have a very conventional way of generating. And the big drama is that the inequality of China, which is to say the imbalance of poor consumption, is only compensated by the consumption of the Americans. So you understand that the two inequality regimes are complementary. Let me add now Europe. Europe was well known for making compatible high welfare and competitiveness. You still have countries like Germany, Denmark, Sweden, Finland, we can manage the compatibility of dynamic efficiency and welfare. But Southern Europe doesn't manage, and therefore you have the following drama. Public opinion has a strong love for welfare, but by lack of competitiveness, you have to cut in Spain, in Greece, civil servant wage, which is not so severe if you are not a civil servant, but access to education, welfare, and so on. So you understand that the dilemma is that you love equality, but your industrial basis is not able to sustain. And this is the drama. And this is not universal. Some countries can do in, and therefore you understand. And then what is my interpretation of the success of Latin America? You reduce inequality because you have the dynamism, cumulative dynamism of China and US, and if, as Professor Ocampo mentioned, we stop, then be careful. You don't have the way to tax and to finance welfare. Second, you have a process of democratization in the sense that the poor citizen had access to the constitution of welfare. And you have political change, which is entitled to develop, especially for Brazil, a large domestic market. And you understand that, again, you have the paradox of declining inequality in Latin America in the context of threat about equality in the rest of the country. And you understand the huge complexity of the world economy according to this kind of analysis. Let me turn to the front. If you have a new innovator, for example, if you want to develop a new drug, a new medicine, it takes maybe 12 or 15 years. But within a few months, the variability of inflow of capital is such that the evolution of the real exchange rate has huge variation. Imagine when this is the rates of exchange between the dollar and an average exchange rate of emerging countries. When you divide it by two, by you appreciate by two the level, no industrial policy can cope with this huge variability of exchange rate. So the question is not only the misalignment, but the unpredictability of the evolution, which makes industrial policy very difficult, because because you need a lot of time to have maturing infant industry. So I think much more than the question of permanent misalignment, you have to turn exchange rate from a financial-led variable into a real variable which warrants the long-term competitiveness. And we are very far away from this. And so it is why I'm so... And where does protectionism come from? If you cannot control this because finance is leading, you will become protectionist. So you can you have a spillover from the lack of control of finance into the risk of protectionism by lack because country can do this. Then why it is so difficult to have a development strategy? Because you have, at least in the vertical line, you have three scenarios. Muddling through, let's try to continue to solve one crisis after another. Then you have the idea, collapse and bifurcation. You could well imagine the equivalent of the interwar period, a kind of collapse of the world economy. And then, of course, you have a very, let's come back Keynes, and you a real Bretton Woods system. And if you look carefully, each development strategy can have very diverse impact. For example, imagine that you have a breaking down of the world economy. France should be in better shape than Germany because we have a consumer-led growth, whereas the German is totally export-led. So you see, you might have a reversal of history according to the fate of the world economy. And this makes industrial policy and planning very difficult because you have to have contingent planning. You have to have the main scenario, and you have to take into account the fact that this scenario can be totally wrong, and then you end up in the worst of the world, in the sense that all your strategies have been very adapted to a world economy deepening of division of labor, reversed brutally. So you understand why the situation and financial markets do replicate this uncertainty. They go from one typical optimist to, for example, let's take the crisis of euro. After each Euroman summit, financiers are very happy. 2 days after, they're again pessimistic, and so on. You have a poor, because by lack of political authority at the national level, you don't have any long-run common view in order to stabilize the Keynesian animal spirit. Let me mention something. If you do econometric study, what is the main explaining variable of the economic activity in Mexico and in the rest of America? Mexico are still depending of American economic activity. And the more recent data you use, the more Brazil is depending from China. So I think, for example, from this point of view, it's very difficult to have a joint common market with Mexico because by definition, trajectory has been removed by totally different trends. Lesson 9, maybe you could imagine that Europe could become a small, old, dipping continent. And the new feature will be south-south complementarity. Let me imagine what this is doing. I'm taking this diagram, describes the revealed competitive advantage of all countries. Along the horizontal axis, on one side, at the left-hand side, you have primary resource specialization. In the left, right-hand side, you have manufacturing. The vertical axis, you specialize in services, and the lower part in industry. As you might know from one period to other, Asia is specializing more and more in manufacturing, and Latin America more and more in primary commodity, even in Brazil, with some small exception in Uruguay, specializing in services. So you see clearly that if you don't have a clear innovation policy, you have the mechanism of market do destroy the past trajectory of industrialization, which is very preoccupying because I was thinking ex ante, what Brazil was the most resilient to this. But due to the strength of revaluation of exchange rate, pressure of Chinese to have contract, in spite of the will to industrialize, you are stuck by your previous specialization. Let me add, and I will jump quickly to this. Then you have a difficult trade-off. It was common sense to say that export-led was very good when you have a very dynamic world economy. But in this diagram, in the vertical axis, you have the volatility of GDP. And the horizontal one, you try to measure trade-offness and financial integration to the world economy. And as you might see, the more integrated to the world economy, the more volatile you are. Therefore, you have a trade-off. if the world economy is in good shape, you are benefiting a lot. You can fight against poverty. But if you have a reversal, on the contrary, you are very weak because you have been losing your national tools in order to govern your economic activity. And I think this is a big drama in the sense the most successful countries in the period of happy globalization might be the worst in a period of protectionist chaos or financial protectionism. You understand better the complexity of the present situation. Then let me mention third. Then I think what impressed me, you go to Switzerland, you have very careful, conservative political power. Swiss has a very competitive manufacturing sector. But if all the uncertain venture capital comes to Switzerland, they bankrupt the world economy. So they adopt a very drastic equivalent of tax just to protect. And what is interesting is not only Chile, but it's simply for macroeconomic stability stake, you not at all ideology, you might absolutely need control of capital. And I think you have an evolution of IMF slowly recognizing that misallocation is existing, but the macroeconomic loss are far higher than the misallocation due to the tax. So, and I think it is very interesting to have this element in Switzerland, and which is an unemblematic case. 13, governments discarded planning. I was personally working for a planning institute, and the big thing is good time. You have a long-term forecasting, and then by discussion between social partners, you detect a trajectory. You will invest in infrastructure, airport, and you have a tentative coherent system. With the victory of free marketers, you say, no, the financial markets are too clever, much more clever than us. Let us delegate to them the allocation of capital. And then what is interesting, you have a totally pro-cyclical. Everybody wants us to give money to Greece when they don't need it. And now nobody wants to give to them, who has the absolute need. So in a sense, you build a pro-cyclicity still exacerbated. In this context, it is very important to have a public bank. In the sense, the public bank is financed in order to long-term planning, planet evolution. If not, the system can collapse by the very efficiency of financial markets. You have oversupply, undersupply of credit. So you have a rehabilitation of public investment bank. Contrary to the idea that they are wasting money. No, they are warranting them. And I think it is very important to rejuvenate. We used to have it in France, and with the shrinking of the public sector, private capital has been invading the territory in such a way that we still have, but we are too teeny to have a real example. And maybe we should study more carefully the case of Brazil. Let me add, what is very impressive is that when you look back the text on World Bank, financial globalization was supposed to help development. Rich country will invest in poor country in order to propel their growth. If I look carefully, the poor Chinese are financing the welfare, the luxury, the blend luxury consumption of American. And second, globalization is exacerbating the pro-cyclicity of the world economy. So in a sense, you are losing on stability of the world economy, and we have been losing on the welfare of the world economy. Let me conclude briefly. First, I think the period of crisis are very good. Regulation theory emerged out of the crisis for this, because then you do not understand the world. You have to work out new analytical context. You have today to assess the past, you have to learn, and you have to invent new way of thinking the economy. Then also, what is very important, you need, I hope that now in French university, you continue to teach dynamic, stochastic, general equilibrium. You don't teach Minsky or O'Donnell model. You don't need, you continue to see. But my argument is that after one decade, maybe you will have again a period of high theory. So I agree with Ocampo. We should have to struggle for being part of the reconstruction of a relevant political economy, not simply in the late place, but at the forefront, because we need absolutely to reconstruct this element. And what is very, very important, since the crisis of development theory began well before the crisis of America, I think Latin American or ASEAN do have a vantage point. because they have a different point of view in order to reconstruct the world economy. And my final guess is the following. Imagine that China, via crisis, what will come, becomes one of the leading places where economists are trained all over the world. You will have a totally new economic theory, much more pragmatic, centered over dynamic process, exactly in the line of the CEPAL initial analysis. For the Chinese, everything is process. Equilibrium does not exist. Imagine the social chance, which will be totally dynamical and linking social process, ecology, and political process. I think this might be one of the future of the political economy. And I'm very sad to see that Europe is far away to be the leader in this kind of elements. It's continuing sticking to the old orthodoxy by lack of alternatives. Sorry for being so pessimistic and disappointing, but I hope new generation will try to fulfill all the gaps of my presentation. Thank you so much for your patience.